Professor Hans Morgenthau, who appeared on this program a few years ago, is one of the half dozen best-known academicians in the United States. He divides his time equally between teaching, writing books and articles, and advising American presidents. He was born in Germany, but has been here since 1937, teaching law and foreign relations and political science. Until Vietnam came along, his reputation was as a hardliner. Then suddenly he was showing up at anti-war rallies, whooping it up for George McGovern in 1971. Then a few weeks ago, he found himself reviewing a book by the younger Gromyko, denouncing it as containing every superstition about America that over the decades has settled in the fever swamps of Soviet ideology. He found it particularly significant that the author of this wild book has been a member of the Arbatov Institute in Moscow, which is supposed to instruct Soviet leadership on the United States as it actually is. Right now, the quarrel among strategic analysts is over the perspective the Middle East explosion of October gave us on detente. There are those who say that detente served to contain the explosion, others who say it exposed detente as the semantic delusion it always was. I'd like to begin by asking Professor Morgenthau whether he believes that Gromyko's book in fact suggests current Soviet thinking about America.
Let me say first of all that I have not recently advised American presidents. As concerns your question, I would guess that it actually reflects the image which Soviet leaders have of the outside world. For the indoctrination with a pseudo-Leninist Marxist dogma is so tight, so non-permissive of any deviation, that I cannot imagine anybody who is not really a genius or an extremely independent spirit, like the few dissenters in the Soviet Union, cannot toe the party line concerning the nature of the outside world, especially insofar as the economic determinism is concerned, monopolies determining American foreign policy and whatnot.
Well, now, Mr. Arbatov was invited by the Washington Post to reply to your criticism, and he defended his institute and Gromyko's book by saying that, after all, it was written in 1964, 1965, 1966, during a period when the United States hadn't discovered the joys of detente.
Yes, but it has been reissued this year. I mean, this is what Mr. Arbatov didn't mention.
So that disposes of that.
Well, surely. Yeah. I mean, all right, you can say that in 65 and 66, the situation in the United States was different, but they put their stamp of approval on this book by reissuing it.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, in the light of what you say, would it not follow that all of the expressions of goodwill and all of the pledges exchanged by Mr. Brezhnev and Nixon were, insofar as Mr. Brezhnev was concerned, duplicitous?
Well, they were duplicitous only in the sense in which all such professions of eternal friendship are duplicitous. When King Faisal calls Mr. Kissinger a sincere man, he probably uses his own standard of sincerity and find him less duplicitous than he himself. So I would not pay any attention to that. I mean, this is part of the diplomatic ceremonial, which means nothing.
Mm-hmm. All right, then, the meaning of detente in the light of its having been accepted as doctrine now in American foreign relations reduces to what?
Well, first of all, let me say, we have a very unfortunate tendency to go from one extreme to the other. Before 1970 or so, the Russians were the incarnation of evil. not only to be contained, but to be rolled back and, if possible, to be wiped off the face of the earth. Now, all of a sudden, they have become friends, nice people, and we did exactly the same kind of thing with Stalin. You will remember, we called Stalin Uncle Joe, a very nice uncle with lots of blood on his hands. And we thought, and Mr. Roosevelt thought, that he could charm Mr. Stalin into cooperation. When this illusion was dissipated by Stalin's foreign policies very quickly. Now, at present, there is detente in a limited sense. It started with the liquidation of the dispute about the territorial status quo in Central Europe until the so-called Ostpolitik of Chancellor Brandt. We had the position, and NATO had the position, more particularly West Germany had the position that the line of demarcation, which was established by the contending armies at the end of the Second World War, was a provisional line, that the division of Germany was provisional, that the annexation of the eastern part of Germany by the Soviet Union and Poland was provisional. And the Cold War arose out of this contest. Now, Mr. Brandt reconciled himself, in my view very wisely, to the inevitable. He recognized the division of Germany. He recognized the irremediable loss of the eastern provinces of Germany. And that, of course, created detente. And we subscribed, hesitatingly, to Mr. Brandt's policy. The second source of detente is the problem which the Soviet Union has with China. No power can afford a two-front confrontation, let alone a two-front war. So in the measure that the relations between the Soviet Union and China deteriorated, the relations between the Soviet Union and its Western neighbors and the United States improved. Thirdly, you have had a kind of detente because the Soviet Union is, in a sense, a partially underdeveloped country, which now has proven, in spite of Mr. Khrushchev's prophecies to the contrary, that it cannot compete effectively with the United States in modern technology, especially in the field of electronics, mass production, and so forth, and therefore needs the help of the West. And so Mr. Brezhnev has become a kind of super salesman who has attracted American businessmen with expectations of enormous profits in order to shore up the sagging economy of the Soviet Union. Mm-hmm. So those are the concrete sources of detente.
Well, now you have listed three situations in describing detente. In the first, detente resulted by the West's withdrawing any irredentist claims to Eastern Europe. In the second, detente resulted by the United States ending his ostracism of China. And in the third, detente was furthered by the United States granting huge economic credits and sending huge supplies of wheat to the Soviet Union. Now, in any of those situations, what was the quid pro quo?
Well, that is a very good question, and I really don't have a very good answer. Because the Soviet Union yielded nothing except rhetoric. They don't call West Germany anymore a fascist country, a revanchist country, the spearhead of American imperialism. But take Gromyko's book. You have exactly the same doctrine the Russians have ever held, but it is no longer expressed in crude and offensive terms by the leaders of the Soviet Union. Brezhnev has adopted the bear hug as a diplomatic ploy, and which is perhaps, I don't know whether it's more pleasant, but it's probably less aggravating than the insults we used to suffer from the rhetoric of the Soviet Union. But I see nothing else tangible which has occurred as a compensation for the concessions we have made. Well, you may, of course, argue, if I may say one more word about this, that the concession concerning the territorial status quo in Central Europe was not a real concession. It was also only a rhetorical concession, because nobody could do anything about it except to defeat the Soviet Union.
Well, it contrasts rather conspicuously with how we handled, say, Okinawa. We returned it, and in that sense, we didn't ask them to accept that which was de facto and make it de jure, which is a contrast in styles. Well, let me ask you this. How do you reconcile America's reputation for being a hard bargainer in the Yankee tradition with what you've just finished telling us as a professor of international relations, that the whole of America is hypnotized by detente, when in fact the enemy, or as we used to call it, has made no substantial concessions of any sort except rhetorical?
There is no reconciliation between those two attitudes. And it is quite possible, let me take for a businessman, for instance, to be very hard-headed and realistic when he deals with a customer or a competitor on the domestic scene, and completely blind and full of illusions when he deals with the Soviet Union.
Does Gromyko's book say why?
Of course it says why, and Lenin said why.
Why?
Because the profit motive, the lust for gain, is so strong in the Western capitalists, and here I'm quoting, that they will hand to the Bolshevists the rope with which the Bolshevists will hang them. Mm-hmm. And I have used the simile of the lemmings rushing into the sea and drowning there. So the American capitalists have rushed to Moscow for orders and long credits, and of course they are not long-term credits, and of course they are not going to see much of that money for decades, if ever.
Well, that brings us to oil. But before we do that, Kissinger is not a businessman, and yet doesn't he give the appearance of being drugged by
yes,
the same...
Yes, he is, because he as a president, has a personal stake in detente. That is his great achievement. In a sense, he has created peace out of hostility. He has done something which none of his predecessors was able and willing to do, and he deserves the gratitude of mankind which has come to him through the Nobel Peace Prize, you might say. So he has his ego is directly involved with the concreteness and veracity of the talk.
But you just told me there was nothing concrete about it except unilateral capitulations by the West.
Yeah, but still, this is concrete from the Russian point of view. I mean, it means a great deal for the Russians if Mr. David Rockefeller goes to Moscow and one might almost say offers his services. I mean, this is not what Lenin...
I'm sorry. You have to explain the enthusiasm for detente of the American capitalist class of profits, to explain it in Henry Kissinger, an ego trip.
Ego trip the dedication to peace.
Okay, and what about...
The peacemaker.
How do you explain it to the
Prince
American...
The Prince of Peace.
How do you explain the gullibility of your colleagues in the university world?
Politely. That is probably a subject for another program. Well, my colleagues in the academic world have had a tendency to follow the party lines, the official orthodoxy. Look at Vietnam. I mean, the opposition to Vietnam did not come primarily from political scientists or from experts in international relations, but from physicists, chemists, and people who had no business really to have an opinion on foreign policy. But academicians are very conformist. They follow the official line. If detente should break down tomorrow, somebody will write a book showing that this was inevitable.
Well, someone always writes a book, but
will
that book represent a defection by the academic class, broadly speaking, from the politics of detente?
No, I would not say that at all. I mean, the point I was really making is that most academicians have not an independent opinion which they are willing to express in opposition to the official position. If the official position is crusade against Bolshevism, academicians will write, have written books.
When did they do that?
In the 50s, 40s, 60s. And now they will write, of course, books concerning the desirability and the blessings of detente.
I can think of three books published in the 50s by academics calling for crusading against Bolshevism. I think you wrote two of them.
I don't believe that. You must have mixed up the title pages.
In other words, what you're saying is that it is a completely footloose constituency that rides ideological passions, and the passion at this moment is to consider that international communism has been exorcised. Now, was that changed by the Middle Eastern developments?
Well, it is too early to say, because the government has not officially assessed the consequences of the Middle East situation with regard to detente, which I think are very serious, because as I see it, the Middle East imbroglio is really a conflict between the United States and the Soviet Union for control of not only of Middle Eastern oil, but of the landmass which connects Africa, Europe, and Asia.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. May I just say one word about your little attack on books I have written in the 50s?
No, I was complimenting you.
You were complimenting. I was so prepared for an attack that I'm completely put off balance by a compliment from you. I think I have already recovered my psychological equilibrium. And I want to say this, I have never thought of the Cold War in terms of an ideological crusade, but always in terms of the threat which a powerful Russia constitutes for the West. And this position I hold today.
Yes, but it's a powerful Russia, you began the hour by saying, fueled by a series of misapprehensions which are ideological in nature,
this
right?
This is correct.
Okay.
This is correct. And so, of course, communism supports the imperialistic and expansionist tendencies of eternal Russia, you might say.
Right. Now, how do you handle the claim made a week or so ago that but for the personal relationship established between Nixon and Brezhnev, we might have had in the Mideast something much more explosive than what we did have?
I think, if I may say so, that is absolute nonsense.
I think so too. Now, how do you handle the fact that so many other people don't think it's nonsense?
Well, because they are not well informed.
Like, why isn't the Washington Post well informed? They've got, you know, lots of reporters around.
Yeah, and perhaps
are they vicious and distorted?
Don't have enough energy anymore to read the Washington Post daily, which I once did. I have to limit myself to the New York Times, so I don't know what the Washington Post has said. But certainly, problem we have had and we are having with the Soviet Union in the Middle East is a clear case of confrontation, of competition, of conflict. And I should say in passing that the alert was caused by a much more serious matter than the readiness of parachute troops in the Soviet Union, which had been a fact long before the alert was pronounced. The alert was declared when we had incontrovertible intelligence that a Russian ship loaded with nuclear missiles had entered the port of Alexandria. And when we declared the alert, that ship turned around and went away.
Well, Mr. Morgenthau, you are familiar, I take it, with the military aspect of these power relations. It remains, I think, true that the overwhelming majority of the American people, and all but unanimously the academic set, seem to be opposed to the maintenance of a military that proceeds pari passu with the Soviet Union, so that we are left today in a situation in which 4 or 5 years from now we could not convincingly cause any Soviet vessel in Alexandria to turn around and go home. Is that correct?
That is not, I wouldn't say that it's not quite correct. You see, first of all, you have to make a distinction between nuclear and conventional weapons. As far as nuclear weapons are concerned, there exists and there will exist for the foreseeable future a balance of terror which has restrained both superpowers in the past and is likely to restrain them in the future. And it is, in my view, entirely irrelevant whether this balance shifts from one side to the other, that one side has 10% or 20% more than the other, because as long as we and the Russians have the capability, or at least both of us believe to have the capability, to destroy each other or to inflict upon each other unacceptable damage, the balance will hold. With regard to conventional weapons, this is an entirely different matter.
Before we turn to conventional weapons, let's explore the other for a moment. It is a sobering but generally acknowledged fact that the Soviet Union's preparations are incomprehensible, except insofar as it would like to amass a first strike capability. Now, since it is inconceivable that we would ever use any first strike capability, you can't theoretically conceive of a situation in which, if the Soviet Union were to fire the nuclear shot, we would be left with a handful of submarines and certainly the right to destroy 100 million Soviet lives if we chose to do so, but it is almost inconceivable that we would choose to do so.
Well,
this would end the balance of terror in the terms of which you discuss it, which are conventional.
But you have used twice the term inconceivable in a context which I would not accept completely. You see, our attempt to preserve a second strike capability, quantitatively and qualitatively, merges imperceptibly in the attempt to acquire a first strike capability. For if you have enough of a second strike capability, you might, by that very same token, have acquired a first strike capability.
Or a first strike deterrent.
Or capability, I mean, is about the same thing. So there is, I think, an inherent dynamics in this situation, which leads both sides to increase ever more the nuclear arms race, first of all, in order to have a second strike capability, but perhaps also by doing that to gain a first strike capability.
Correct. Now, if it then follows, as you suggest it will, through these subtle permutations, that there is a balance of terror, then conventional weaponry is critical.
Of course it is.
And in conventional weaponry, 2 or 3 or 4 years from now, we would presumably find ourselves relatively impoverished in attempting to maintain the stability of the Middle East.
Even today, if it were not for the nuclear threat which was implicit in the alert, we would be pretty helpless. And if you imagine for a moment the opening of the Suez Canal, our departure from Bahrain, which has been requested for our naval forces, and the massive Russian naval presence in the Eastern Mediterranean and in the Indian Ocean, you would have a very serious situation.
Mm-hmm.
And you see, this situation reflects the basic political and military strategy of the Soviet Union, which is to move into the empty spaces which have been left by the liquidation of the British and French empires.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if you imagine a Soviet Union, in naval dominance of the Eastern Mediterranean, of the Persian Gulf, of the Indian Ocean, and with the political situation and military situation as it might develop in the Middle East itself, on land, the Soviet Union would occupy the position of predominance Great Britain occupied before the end of the Second World War.
Well, not only would it, but much more so, it would seem to me, especially now that we've had this showcase demonstration of the critical value of 60% of the world's known deposits of oil. Now, what I would like to know is, when you take into consideration, A, the relative disarmament of the United States, B, the insubstantial concessions under detente by the Soviet Union, C, the enormous appetite for an oil, the withholding of which can and would affect the public policies, let alone the industrial survival of Japan and the Western Europe. How is it conceivable, in the light of those factors, that detente in the Middle East could last more than 2 or 3 years?
Well, there is no, first of all, there is no detente at present. There is,
well, there's a ceasefire.
A ceasefire, but I mean, we are talking now about the Arabs and the Israelis?
I'm talking about stability in the Middle East.
Stability in the Middle East you will probably get at the expense of Israel. And you see,
this is a price that we're not prepared to pay. The United States.
Have you any inside information about this?
Inside and outside.
We have
a joint resolution of Congress in 1957 reaffirmed 2 weeks ago.
Right. But military and political exigencies have again their own force, which is much greater than a joint resolution.
Are you predicting the end of Israel?
I do not predicting it. But I think it is more possible now than it ever was since Israel was founded as an independent state.
And are you serene about this?
I'm not serene about it, but I have tried to accustom myself to facing the facts as they are, however disagreeable they may be in terms of my preferences.
Well, is this something that indicts American statecraft?
It does not indict it. But it becomes the consequence of the conflict, of the competition between the United States and the Soviet Union for dominance in the Middle East, especially in view of the oil problem you have mentioned. You see, you can see already the effects of the beginnings of that policy in the drastic improvement of our relations with Egypt, which has caused considerable discomfort in Moscow. So this is what Kissinger is after, to displace dominant Russian influence in the Middle East, which can only be achieved at the sacrifice of Israel. That is to say, Mr. Sadat will ask himself, who will give me what I want in terms of my relation with Israel? The Russians have given him arms, which have been not sufficient. Only the Americans can give him the diplomatic and economic pressure which is necessary to bring the Israeli government to terms.
Well, there is no doubt that Mr. Kissinger's present plans call for a retrenchment in Israel, but there is also no doubt that his present plans call for the survival of Israel.
Of course, his plans
were... And that all the representations by Sadat are in that direction. Sadat is not saying, now we are close to the liquidation of Israel, is he?
You know, Chamberlain in 38 also was in favor of survival of Czechoslovakia. And Hitler gave him also insurances in that respect. So all depends, the whole problem hinges upon... the credibility and the meaning, I shouldn't say really credibility, but the meaning of Sadat's statements. Now, one of the often repeated statements of Sadat has been that in a peace settlement, the rights of the Palestinians must be recognized. What are the rights of the Palestinians? To return to from where they expelled or from where they migrated in the last 25 years. That is where the state of Israel is today. So there is implicit in Sadat's statements, you see...
Well, those are capable of exegesis. Sure, those rights could be indemnification.
Surely, as Hitler's statements in 1938 were capable of exegesis, and Mr. Chamberlain said on his deathbed, everything would have turned out all right if Hitler hadn't lied to me. And perhaps somebody will, Mrs. Meyer will once say, Mr. Kissinger, everything would have turned out all right in the Middle East if Mr. Sadat had not lied to me.
Well, I'm not disputing the tendency of your strategic analysis, because it seems to me that detente and the superstitions that we have accepted and the cooperation that we are undertaking with the Soviet Union spell, among other things, the end of Israel. I'm opposed to the detente, I'm opposed to this kind of economic cooperation, and I'm in favor of the survival of Israel. Who says A must say B? And it is true that if we so fashion our foreign policy as to make it impossible for us to survive in the Eastern Mediterranean with a pop gun, we're not going to stay the Soviet Union when it desires the
this
oil.
This is correct.
Now, but my own solution was considered very frivolous. I made it a year ago, which was that we annex Israel, make it the 51st state, which would make things an awful lot easier.
Among it other would things, also create some logistic problems.
Everything creates problems, but it would also have ended the question about the survival of Israel, wouldn't it?
This is correct.
And would have given us one foreign policy instead of one and a half. But your pessimism is a little bit fatalistic.
It's not fatalistic. I see the trend of American policy. I take, for instance, an incident which occurred at the beginning of the ceasefire, when the United States demanded from the Israeli government to supply the surrounded Third Egyptian Corps. Mm-hmm. And Dayan called, Kissinger was on the phone, and said, "This is absurd. We are at war, and you ask us to supply our enemy." And Kissinger said, "If you don't supply them, we will supply them. And furthermore, you have to wage your next war alone." And Dayan then said, "We were under such pressure that we had to accept."
Well, that's typical of a client state. Israel is a client
state. Well,
surely
it's a client state. This is, of course, the tragedy of Israel, that it cannot pursue, cannot afford to pursue a foreign policy at variance with the basic objectives of the United States. And the basic objectives of the United States are now to gain a foothold in the Arab world, to push the Russians out of the Middle East, at least, or diminish their influence, in order to prevent the Russians from controlling the Middle East strategically, and more particularly in terms of oil.
Well, those objectives are perfectly reasonable,
sure.
But it also follows, does it not, that we must fail in those objectives if they are attempted at the same time as we proceed with the progressive conventional disarmament.
Well, surely, if we do not recognize the military threat which, on a conventional level, the Soviet Union constitutes in Europe and elsewhere, of course, everything else we do will be of very little avail. I mean, take if you may discuss this for a moment. Take Europe. The Russians have talked endlessly for years about European security. And of course, what they mean is their own security. Naturally, and if I were a Russian, that is what I would be interested in. And then, if I put myself in the position of a Russian statesman, I ask myself, what would be, from the Russian point of view, the prerequisites of Russian security?
To which you would answer what?
First, the diminution, if not expulsion, of American influence in Western Europe. Secondly,
why is that a threat?
It's a threat in the sense that obviously one cannot foresee.
It's a threat to their expansion, but not to their survival.
Not to their survival, but we are talking about expansion.
Ah.
I mean, Israel has to talk about survival, but fortunately, we and the Russians talk about expansion. and the military presence of the United States as the western frontiers of the Russian Empire, composed of very unwilling elements on its western borders, is of course a threat. It must be conceived by the Russians as a threat. Get that threat out of the way, NATO becomes an empty shell. And more particularly, and most importantly from the Russian point of view, the Federal Republic of Germany will be isolated. And then we come to the prophecy of Khrushchev, which he has expressed time and again in private conversations. And I have said it, I have quoted it so often that I can recite it verbatim. He said to Sparks, the late prime and foreign minister of Belgium, there will be another Rapallo, another agreement between Russia and Germany after the model of the Rapallo Treaty of 1921. It will not come under me. It will not come under my successor. But it will come under my successor's successor. It is inevitable, and we can wait. Mm-hmm. And there are tendencies within West Germany, and in the United States, I should say, which play directly into the hands of this kind of plan, long-range plan, long-range design, which the Russians have for Europe. And then what you will get is some middle-rank states in Western Europe, which will be like a somewhat aggrandized Sweden or Denmark, mm-hmm. what is called generally the Finlandization of mm-hmm. Europe. And the Soviet Union will be the undisputed master of the Eurasian landmass, being able to concentrate exclusively upon the Chinese threat.
Now, I return to the fact of your fatalism. There is no question in my mind that these are the tendencies, and that this is the vector of them, and that this is what would result from them. I ask you, is there latently resistance to such developments forming either in Western Europe or in the United States? If so, who is spearheading them?
You mean a resistance to...
To a public policy that would make this possible.
But you mean to invest in Europe?
Yeah.
Of course there is an opposition, especially by by our administration. The president and Mr. Kissinger have been adamant, for instance, against the Mansfield Amendment to unilaterally and drastically reduce our military presence.
But isn't that meaningless in the larger...
In larger terms,
because if we give in with the detente, which you have just finished agreeing has hypnotized the whole of the United States, then we are undermining the reason for keeping American troops in West Germany.
Well, this is of course correct, but then you have to follow one trend of logic and dismiss the other trend, which you regard to be unsound to begin with. And you see, our military presence in West Germany has not primarily a military purpose, but has a political purpose to keep the West Germans on our side. I mean, there is a great deal of schizophrenic thinking in West Germany. On the one hand, they resent, of course, the American military presence in their own country. On the other hand, they are mortally afraid of the Russians. And this, of course, is a fear which goes back hundreds of years. I mean, I just recently read a book which was published 100 years ago in France with drawings by Gustave Doré about eternal Russia. And I was amazed at the similarity of the feelings and of the overall situation which existed then in Western Europe with regard to Russia. Here is the colossus from the East, that Oriental despotism, the Russian bear, which threatens the freedoms and the civilization of Western Europe. And this is still true today in the face of an enormously weakened Europe, which needs America in order to hold its own against this enormous pressure.
Professor Richard Venata is with the School of International Service at American University. Mr. Venata.
Well, I've been somewhat interested in finding the extent of agreement amongst you two here on the question of the implications of detente policy for the history that is unfolding of the world today. And I am quite perplexed about the way in which we have dismissed the motivations of detente, the need, at some extent, after the Cuban Missile Crisis in particular, to in some way or other strike a new structure of expectations between the Americans and the Russians with regard to the scope of their conflict and their violence towards each other. And it seems to me that what you're saying now is that there is a danger in cooperating too much, that we can be lulled asleep here, and that the Russians will catch us unawares in the Middle East, will take over Europe on the basis of us suddenly forgetting that the Russians and us have any kind of competitive interest. Now, I think you've gone much too far in this direction.
Well, I've not used those expressions, and I do not agree with them. But we haven't got time to go into this. Let me only say one thing. It's the idea that a nuclear war between the United States and the Soviet Union must be avoided is not a new invention. It has nothing to do with detente. It's a mere commonsensical statement with which everybody except a madman must agree.
But how do we structure the expectations of the Russians in their dealings with us in such a way that they find that for them to raise the costs of the conflict are not worthwhile?
You raise them by the normal diplomatic pressures and expectations and promises and so forth.
We've done this
all along. You see, we forget how enormously restrained and how unprecedentedly restrained our and Soviet foreign policy have been since 1945. In the pre-nuclear age, you would have been at war with the Soviet Union over any number of issues.
But one thing I find here is that you seem to feel that our actions, particularly with regard to Western Europe and our economic relations with the Soviet Union, Mr. Buckley here in particular finds these to be somewhat troublesome to him. It seems to me that the whole intention here, in fact, is to somehow restructure the Russians' involvement with us in such a way that they find it to be less profitable to engage in this worldwide expansion, which you seem to hold.
You see, this is the 19th century liberal conception of the beneficial effects of free trade, which is really not borne out by history. It's quite possible to have very intimate and extensive trade relations and very antagonistic political relations at the same time.
Let me say one word about the
trade business. I think we are vis-a-vis the Russians in the same position in which the Russians were vis-a-vis the Chinese in 1959. Are we going to supply the most sophisticated implements of modern warfare to a nation which may still be or might be again our enemy?
To which the answer is what?
It's no.
It's yes. We are going to.
All right.
Dr. Jeffrey Ryman is with the College of Public Affairs at American University.
Yeah, I'm not really clear on your prognosis about Israel. It seemed to me that at one point you were more or less deducing from American interests the disappearance of Israel. And at another point you suggested that American relationships with Egypt are on the upswing because Mr. Kissinger has what Sadat wants, which I think you termed as making Israel come to terms. Now, as far as I can see, there's quite a difference between the disappearance of Israel and making Israel come to terms.
I have not prophesied the disappearance of Israel. You don't find my name in the Bible, even under minor prophets. Perhaps in the next edition. This is going to happen piecemeal. Let me suppose we force the Israelis back into the frontiers of 67. Well, let me put it differently. Let me ask you this. If the recent war, would have broken out with the Israelis on the frontiers of 67, what would have happened with the Israelis? In other words, the Israelis might well once be in a position of such hopeless military inferiority that she will be simply an object for the discretion of the Arabs. The Arabs can do with them what they want to.
But don't you think that there are some realistic interests that the United States has in maintaining the existence of Israel?
Of course it has very realistic interests in it, very tangible interests, but you see, the issue doesn't present itself to Mr. Nixon or Mr. Kissinger in terms of the survival of Israel or its destruction. The issue presents itself in much smaller, unobtrusive terms, which in sum will lead to a very difficult position of Israel. To a very, perhaps a hopeless position for Israel. I mean, in the same way in which the issue of Czechoslovakia and of the Third World War didn't present itself to Mr. Chamberlain in such simple terms, it presented itself in terms of national self-determination for an oppressed minority in Czechoslovakia, allegedly oppressed minority in Czechoslovakia. And the London Times wrote an editorial after the Munich Agreement saying, the principle of self-determination, which the West has stipulated, has been evoked by its enemies, and their appeal has been allowed. And it was very proud of its objectivity and justice.
But we have developed techniques on the basis of which we have protected enclaves. We protected West Berlin. We protected Chemo and Maxey.
Yeah, by putting troops.
We know how to do it. Yeah.
Sure. Well, obviously, yeah. The policy of containment was successful, because American troops manned the line of demarcation of 1945, which says in so many words, if one Russian soldier crosses a line of demarcation, the Soviet Union will be automatically at war with the United States. Mm-hmm. Sure, if we were to deploy an American division at the frontiers of a truncated Israel, Israel would be safe. But is this a realistic proposition?
Given the fact that you're not a prophet, how can you foresee what in fact will be the peacekeeping arrangement that we anticipate for that area?
Well, I cannot anticipate them in detail, but I can understand the general trend of our policy. In putting myself in Mr. Kissinger's shoes, I can foresee what an intelligent diplomatist would do to implement, what we would have to do to implement that policy. I mean, in other words, if you want to come to terms with the Arabs, if you want to be the friends of the Arabs instead of the Russians, you have to do something about Israel. I mean, it's as simple as that.
I know, but it's one thing to do something about Israel in the sense of returning pre-67 territories. It's another to do that to Israel, which automatically means the termination of its independence.
But the restoration of the 67 frontiers means the exposure of, the military exposure of Israel.
Well, I'm not talking about the Golan Heights, but I'm talking about the Sinai Desert and the West Bank.
Also, one needs only to take a look at the map. Here is a salient of Latrun, which almost cuts Israel into half. And the Egyptians have the Russian frog missiles, which have a reach of 40 miles, and to look at that small country.
But how do you know that the Kissinger isn't planning to insist on an effective demilitarization of the area with very, very strict control?
If he can do that, he will have taken a step forward. But the Egyptians in the past have always rejected, for instance, the demilitarization of Sinai. The Israelis have said, we will retreat from Sinai if it is demilitarized.
Yeah, yeah.
And the Russians, the Egyptians have rejected
resisted,
it.
Yeah.
And furthermore, demilitarization is a temporary measure which can be revoked overnight. I mean, take the outbreak of the 67 war, when the Egyptians massed their troops in the Sinai. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Gary Weaver is professor in the School of International Service at American. Dr. Weaver. Mm-hmm.
I'm interested in the word detente and your kind of balance of power emphasis you're still taking here. That is, the idea of a nation state being free to do what it wants to do and balancing off power comes from the 18th and 19th century. And we find ourselves now in the age of nuclear power where the nation state itself can't act. The major states are stuck in a balance of terror, as you call it. What I'm interested in is, what is the possibility that a new actor, an economic actor, is developing, different than the nation state?
Well, are you talking about the multinational corporation?
That's right.
Well, it's of course true that the freedom of action of the nation state has been greatly diminished by modern technological developments. Mm-hmm. I mean, as I've pointed out 25 years ago, the nation state has become as obsolete as a principle of political organization as feudalism did by the first industrial revolution. Mm-hmm. But it exists and acts and makes wars. And furthermore, the balance of power, of course, goes back many centuries. I mean, if you read Thucydides, you will find it there. So I don't think that, I fully agree with you that the present international situation, the present structure of the international situation is obsolescent, mm-hmm. if not obsolete. But there's nothing to put in its place.
Yes, but could a new actor be evolving?
But a new actor would be an anarchical actor, which would have economic interests primarily, mm-hmm. and political interests only insofar as they serve the economic interests of those yeah. actors.
In other words, it might be completely amoral or have no nationalist attack.
Amoral or anarchical force.
Right.
Ms. Venata?
Yes, I'd like to return back to the question of Soviet Union expansionism here and the apparent lack of American ability, as you were trying to point out, to act against this. We're talking about Arabs as if the Arabs themselves are some kind of uniform group of people here. The Saudis and the Kuwaitis
have very little interest in Israel.
With regard to Israel, yes, but with regard to the Soviet Union, no. The Kuwaitis and the Saudi Arabians have absolutely nothing in common or interest to bring to bear with regard to the Russians. They have no trading interests. They have no desire to develop technological relationships with the Russians. It is the Americans who they're going to turn. And the same people, same time, the Russians are turning to the Americans for technological development. So it seems to me that when we're arguing about this conflict perspective, the expansionism here, we have to also temper this with a desire both of the Russians and of many other people for economic and technological improvements, which they have to turn to the United States for. And this is what we can play off in our competition.
I mean, I would agree with you except for the last sentence. I mean, you see, the playoff is a very risky business. For by supplying the Soviet Union with the modern implements of technology, you don't get anything in return.
Well, they have the military technology now.
Pardon me?
They have the military technology now. They have the
military technology only up to a certain point. You see, for instance, in nuclear technology, they limp behind the United States by about 2 or 3 years.
We're not supplying them with military technology.
Yeah, but you cannot make a clear distinction between military and civilian technology. A computer is an indispensable element of military technology, but it can also be used for social science research.
Certainly, but the point that I'm trying to make here is essentially that we're essentially banking perhaps overly sanguine hopes on, if you will, a penetration thesis, that the Soviet Union needs certain kinds of technological, economic development activities that we can supply for them. And therefore, we can, in fact, strike an interdependence here, which would detract from their interests in moving in other ways.
Yeah, well, of course, that comes back to the previous argument that somehow politics follows the trade.
In my view, it's
the exact opposite.
Well,
I think this should be added too, that there is very little that the Soviet Union can't buy in the way of crucial technology from Japan and Western Europe, and if it is in command of all the oil needed in those countries, it certainly is going to be able to pay that.
I mean, it can reduce, if one wants to exaggerate a little bit, Western Europe and Japan to semi-colonial status.
Exactly. I think you should clarify your statement that they are behind on nuclear technology, in as much as we have recently discovered that they have developed, and have already in production a MIRV missile, which is a far greater than ours, giving them a throw weight.
Of course, they have much larger missiles than we have.
So you were
it is an open military question whether it does you any good, because with a smaller missile you can destroy an industrial and population center as effectively as with a bigger missile. The radioactivity may be lower,
it's very good for first strike.
It's very good for first strike, and it's also very good in that you don't need to aim very carefully.
That's right. So when you were talking about our supremacy, you meant what in terms of
still
satellites?
If you look at the general technology, especially MIRVs, you see, we have had operational MIRVs for more than a year, 2 years probably. I mean, the Russians have just started. We have been ahead from the beginning, and we have always had a terrible fear that the Russians will get ahead of us. I think this fear is unfounded for the foreseeable future, short of a technological breakthrough which no natural scientist, no physicist or chemist anticipates.
Thank you very much, Professor Hans Morgenthau, and thank you, gentlemen of the panel, ladies and gentlemen from American University.
Next week, part 3 of the Human Behavior Series features a discussion on limits of behavioral control. Printed bound copy of this program, send 25 cents in coin to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. This program was made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.